I've entitled this Putting Away Dead Works. And I want to, because the Bible talks about dead works from a Christian. So because we know that we need works, right? After faith, we need faith without works is what? It's dead, right?
Yes.
So the Bible has says there's this thing called dead works. And I'm gonna show you what that is today. And I'm going to show you how you do works that aren't dead, living works, works that are going to like when you stand before the Lord, he's going to say, because there are many people when they appear at the judgment seat. What are they going to say? What are these Christians going to say to the Lord? Have we not what?
Done works
prophesied and done all these wonderful works, right? And he's going to declare unto them, I never knew you.
Right.
See, they think that those works that they're doing are works that are going to get rewarded. And the reality is God says they're dead works.
Right.
We want to understand the difference, because why waste your time working for the Lord if they're what? If they're not going to profit you, right?
Right.
All right. So let's read the content. He says, the context, I'm sorry. And the Lord said unto Noah, come thou and all thy house into the ark, for thee, Noah. Now look at the words he uses. For thee, Noah, have I seen what? Right. So God is saying, I looked at Noah and I see that he is righteous before me in this generation. He says, of every clean beast thou shalt take to thee by sevens, and the male and his female, and of beasts that are not clean by two, the male and his female, of fowls also of the air by sevens, the male and the female, to keep seed alive upon the face of the earth. For yet 7 days, and I will cause it to rain upon the earth 40 days and 40 nights. And every living substance that I have made will I destroy from off the face of the earth. And now Lewis says, and Noah did according unto how much?
All
the Lord. So he did some things. So when he did those things, guess what God could say to him? For thee have I what? Mm-hmm. So he directly connects that I've seen that he is righteous because he did what? According unto all that I commanded him to do, right? So we're going to see that exact same thing when we get over to Hebrews 11. He says, by faith, in other words, Noah believed God. That's what faith is. Faith is believing. By faith, Noah, being warned of God of things not seen as yet, guess what he did? He moved, and he what?
Prepared.
So therefore, God could say, I have what?
Seen.
Because you did what?
All
that I commanded you, right? So by and then look what it says. He moved, he prepared an ark to the saving of his house, by the which he condemned the world. And even though he was a believer in God, by working, guess what he did?
He became heir
of the righteousness which is by faith. And we know an heir is a person who has a right to the inheritance. Is there any of you that's going to give your inheritance to a stranger?
No.
Noah's already a child. Lewis is already a child, right? Carlos, Patricia, and John and Love, y'all are already children. And you're children by what? Faith. But guess what? That faith has to be perfected. And how do you perfect faith? You perfect it by adding what to it? By adding works to it, right? So let me show you this. He says, as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead also. So we know the body. When Adam's body was laying on the ground, he had just formed it. God had not breathed into it his spirit or his breath, had he?
No.
So if you don't have breath and you don't have spirit, you're dead, right?
Yes.
So he's going to tell you something here. your faith, just like your body, something gives that body life. Well, guess what gives life to your faith?
Works.
See, faith is the body, and the works are the spirit. So just as the body does have no life in it without the spirit, your faith, right, cannot have any life. Your works have no life, or your faith has no life without works. But we've talked about this before. But what I'm going to show you is something just a little bit different today. Okay, because we want to talk about dead works. Now, look what he says. Therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ, right? So he's talking to a believer, right? He says, after you believe upon Christ as your Savior, let us go on unto what?
Perfection.
So the goal isn't believe upon Jesus and everything's done. That's the beginning. We want to be perfect as our Father in heaven is perfect. And he goes on and tells believers, not laying again the foundation of repentance from what kind of works?
Dead works.
Dead works and of faith toward God. So there is something God considers dead works. We know you have to add works to your faith to give your faith life. Because remember, faith is the body. You add works to it to give what? Life to your faith. But if you're adding works to it to give life to it, but it's not really living works, it's dead works, is that going to give life to your faith?
No.
No. So whatever this thing is called dead works, it is not going to make your faith a living faith. Okay? And look what he says. He says, without faith, it is, look at those words, it is impossible to do what?
Please God.
To please him. So you not only have to have faith, you're going to have works added to that faith to actually please him, and dead works is not going to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe, or must have faith, that he is, and that he is what?
A rewarder.
A rewarder. So if you want to please him, the type of works that you must add to your faith, right, to give them life, to please God, is you're doing those works, adding those works to your faith, believing that he is a what?
Rewarder.
So if you're doing works for any other motive, right, other than believing that God is the rewarder, you cannot please him. Therefore, guess what those works are?
Dead works.
They're dead works. So if you're doing works to be seen of men, if you're doing works so that someone's going to pay you back, if you're doing these works so someone walks up to you and tells you, pats you on the back and tells you how righteous and holy you are, you know what the Bible calls those?
Dead works.
They're dead works. Now, he says, if the blood of bulls and goats and the ashes of a heifer sprinkling the unclean sanctifieth to the purifying of the flesh, how much more should the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from what? Dead works, which are works that are not done, believing that God's rewarder, from dead works to do what? Serve the living God. So the works, the dead works, are works that are done to be seen of men. They're works done so people tell you you're righteous and holy. They're works done so that men will pay you back. If you do good to them, they pay you back, right?
Yes.
He said he wants you to be done with those and do what? And serve the living God. So when you serve the living God, you must believe that that living God is a what?
Rewarder.
A rewarder. Those are living works. Those are works Now remember, faith is the body.
Yes.
Works are the spirit.
Right.
Faith, the body without the spirit is dead. Faith without living works are dead. Faith with dead works are dead. Right? So we need to add living works, which are works believing that he's a rewarder, because without that type of faith, it's not possible to please him. So what does that mean? He says, well, take heed, believer, that you do not your alms. Now, let's look at alms real quick. Anything given gratuitously, right? To relieve the poor as money, food, or clothing. So when you're doing things to help the poor, you're giving money, you're giving food, you're giving clothes, anything you do alms-wise for other men that's done gratuitously. Now let's look at gratuitously. Freely, voluntarily, without claim or what? So you're not looking for somebody to what? Say, well, no, you're such a good holy person. You're not looking for someone to pay you back for doing it. You're doing it gratuitously without an equivalent or what? You're not looking for compensation, are you? Because you believe that the God who is the living God and you're serving him is going to pay you back.
Yes.
He says, take heed that you don't do these things before men to be what? To be seen of them. Because what does gratuitously mean? You're doing it without expecting someone to compensate you, right? And he goes on, and he says, these right here, when you do it before men to be seen of them, the Bible calls this dead works.
Yes.
Because if you're doing it to be seen of them, otherwise, guess what? You have what? No reward of who?
Father.
Now you have reward from men.
Right.
So when you stand at the judgment seat to receive the things done in the body, whether they be good or bad, and you say, well, Lord, I did this and I did that and I did this, what's he going to say to you? I never what? Because those are dead works. You did not do them in secret. He says, therefore, when thou doest thine alms, do not what?
Sound the trumpet.
You know who sounds the trumpet? As the what? The hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, that they may have what?
Glory of men.
So do you want glory from men or glory from God? You make the choice. Because one is a living work, a work that will be rewarded eternally, and one is a work that when it happens at that moment, when you give to someone and everybody sees it and you let everybody know you're sounding the trumpet, it's a dead work. It cannot give life to your faith. He says, verily I say unto you, they have their reward. That's it. So when you stand at the judgment seat and say, well, Lord, I did this, this, and that, he's going to say, you know, when you did that, look back at it. You see that man patting you on the shoulder? You see that man telling you you're holy and righteous? You see that man paying you back by going to his bank account and giving you some money? You see all that was your reward. And when thou doest alms, let not your left hand know what the right hand doeth, that thine alms may, what it says?
Secret.
Be in secret. And thy Father, which seeth in secret, on the judgment seat, shall what? He's going to reward you openly. Now is not the time to be rewarded what? Openly. Now is not the time to be compensated for the things that you're doing. It's through faith and patience, right? We're being patient. We're waiting for him to come back, and then he'll tell us what? Well done, thou good and faithful servant, right? He says, then said he also to him that bade him, when thou makest a dinner or a supper, don't call your friends, your brethren, your kin folks, right? nor your rich neighbors, lest they also bid thee again, and a recompense be made thee. Now, the Lord's not just telling us this for no reason. He's like, if you invite your family and your friends and the rich neighbor, he's saying that a recompense, which is to compensate, to make return of a what?
Equivalent.
Gratuitously means without what? An equivalent. Recompense is to return an equivalent for anything given, done, or suffered. To recompense a person for services, for fidelity, or for sacrifices of time. That's why he says, redeem the what? When you do something that you really don't want to do you know you're making a sacrifice?
Yes.
Will the God of all creation lie if he says he'll pay you back if you do it gratuitously, right? If you do it without the right hand knowing what the left hand, or the left hand not knowing what the right hand is doing, will he pay you back? Is it possible that God can lie?
No.
It is not possible. Therefore, you know what you should do? You should serve him.
Right.
You look what he says here. Now, therefore, this is in Joshua. Now, therefore, believer, this is what you should do. Fear the Lord and what?
Everything.
But don't just serve him. Serve him in sincerity and in truth. And put away the gods which your fathers served, because they served these other gods. You need to serve the true God. He says, put away those gods that you served on the other side of the flood and in Egypt, and serve ye the Lord. Why? Why? Because he's going to pay you back eternally. And if it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord, every believer this day can do what?
Choose.
God's not, listen, you don't have to serve God. You can live for the world. You get a choice. As a believer, when you believe upon Jesus, you can continue to serve the world. You can continue to do all these things and get all these rewards and live in mansions and have 5 cars and whatever you want to do. But God says, when you do that, you're making a choice.
Right.
You got to choose you this day who you're going to serve, whether the gods which your father served that were on the other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. But as for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. What does that mean, serve the Lord? It means to work for him. You're in it. You're employed by God. And you get to serve him in sincerity. Look at that. Honesty of mind or intention, freedom from simulation or from what? Remember what he said up here? He says, what do the hypocrites do? They sound the trumpet. They want to be seen of men, right? He says, you have no reward of your father because you're a hypocrite. You're doing it for the wrong reason. You're not doing it gratuitously. You're not doing it expecting no equivalent or no compensation. You're doing it because you want to get paid back. The Bible calls that dead works. That's what sincerity is. You're not being a hypocrite. You are free from what? Hypocrisy. Do you know that when you go into your room and shut the door and pray in secret, that God will pay you back? Do you know that when you help someone and you don't sound the trumpet and let everybody know that you're doing it, do you know that God will not forget that? He'll pay you back one day. And therefore, it's a matter of faith. Do you believe that? If you believe that, then you have to make a choice. To choose is you have the power of choice, right?
Yes.
You as a believer can do whatever you want to do. You want to sin, you can sin. You want to fornicate, you can fornicate. If you want to be given to idolatry and lie, you can do that. But I'll tell you the same thing that Paul told all the churches he wrote to. He says, don't be deceived. He says, fornicators and idolaters, right? All those sins he listed, you're not going to inherit the kingdom. He says, don't let no man deceive you with vain words. You will not, as a believer, get your inheritance. You have to make a choice. He says, it came to pass after these things that God did tempt Abraham and said unto him, Abraham, he said, behold, here I am. And he said, take now thy son, thine only son, Isaac. Now look, whom thou lovest. Sometimes God's going to ask you to do something because he wants to know who you love the most. Because if you love mother or father more than me, you're not what? Worthy of me. So I want you to take Isaac, who you love, and I want you to get into the land of Moriah, and I want you to offer him for a burnt offering. I want you to sacrifice the thing you love the most to me. That's hard, isn't it?
Yes.
It's really, really hard. And I think that earlier in Abraham's life, he couldn't have done that. But I want you to watch what it says. And Abraham, he stretched forth his hand and he took the knife to slay his son. And the angel of the Lord called unto him out of heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham. And he said, here am I. And he said, lay not thy hand upon the lad, neither do thou anything unto him. Now look what the God of all creation, the God of all knowledge, the God who knows all things says to Abraham. Now I know that thou fearest me. Look at the word. Seeing thou hast not withheld thine only son. Think about that. God says, you know what? Now I know you really believe me. Isn't that the same thing we saw up here? He says, what does he say to Noah? For thee have I what?
Seen.
Why? Because he did what?
According to what God told him.
See, these men added living works to their faith. Not dead works. They weren't. Was Abraham telling everybody, oh, you know, I'm poor me. I got to go up and sacrifice my son.
No.
God wants to see that you believe him. And when you do what he says, believing that he is a rewarder, he can say to you, now I know that you fear me. Now I know that you believe me, love. Now I know you believe me, Lewis. Now I know you believe me, Carlos, Patricia. You know why? Because I can see it. I know you believe me. You are perfecting your faith. Let's look at how this all started. It says, Abraham said, behold, to me, thou hast given no seed. And lo, one born in my house is what? So when I die, I'm going to have to give my inheritance to somebody who is not even my what? My seed. Not even my child. And behold, the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, this shall not be thine heir. This is not the person who's going to get your inheritance. But he that shall come forth out of thine own bowels shall be your heir. And he brought him forth abroad and said, look now toward heaven. And I want you to say something to the stars, Abraham, if you're able to what?
Number them.
Because there are so many, right?
Right.
And he said unto him, so shall thy seed be. So he said, Abraham, you can't count the stars. And that man that's in your house, who's not your seed, he's not going to be your heir. I'm going to bring a seed out of you. His name's Isaac. Because the promise was not just made to Isaac. It was made to Isaac and his seed, which is Christ, right? And he says, you're not going to be able to number the amount of the seed that's going to come from you. And you know what it says? He had faith. He believed in the Lord. And you know what God does? Because do you know Abraham was not a righteous man? Do you know you're not a righteous man? Do you know you're not a righteous person? He says, there's none what? There's none righteous. But God is very merciful. He counts your faith as what? He says, if you believe me, I will count that as you being righteous. And how are you going to, and listen, but that's the beginning of Abram's faith, wasn't it? It wasn't perfected yet. But when he got to a certain point in his life where his faith had been perfected, Abraham perfected his faith by God seeing, now I know that you believe me. Now I know your faith is perfect. That's where we're all trying to get to. That when God tells us to go do something, guess what? We do it. And he looks down on it and says, that is perfect faith. And you'll be just like Noah. What it said about here, about Noah, it says that, and he became the heir of the righteousness, which is by what? Because God counts your faith as what?
Righteousness.
He just wants to see it. He wants it to be perfected. It was perfected in Noah because he believed God and he moved and he what? So do you believe that God is a rewarder? Because if you don't believe it, if you don't have faith, it is what?
Impossible.
It's impossible to please him. Now, so let's look. He says, by faith, Abraham, when he was tried, in other words, when God tempted him, when God tried him, guess what he did? He offered up Isaac, and he that had received the promise, what was the promise? The promise was that boy that you're sacrificing right now, through him is going to come so much seed that you can't what? Number them. But Lord, if I kill him, then what am I going to do? That's where your faith has to be perfected. Because God, is it possible God can lie? It's not. So if God tells you to take the very man that from him is going to come so much seed that you're not going to be able to number it. But now he's telling you to kill him and God can't lie. Then God must going to be able to do something if I kill him. That's perfect faith. Look what he says. And he that had received the promises offered up his only begotten son, of whom it was said that in Isaac shall thy seed be called. Accounting that God was able to what?
Raise him up.
Even from the dead. That is perfect faith. Abraham was going to offer his son. If the Lord didn't stop him, he would have killed him. But you know what God would have had to do to keep his promise? He would have had to what?
Raise him from the dead.
Do you know that one day you're going to die? And that God has promised you certain things? But you're going to die. So you might as well live for the world, right? No, I account that God is able to raise me up even from the what?
Yeah.
And if God says that if I give a cup of cold water in his name, I will in no wise lose my reward. Therefore, you have to make a choice as a believer. He says, by faith, Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. Look at the word. He's making a choice. He chose rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. He made a choice. Esteeming. Now look at that word esteeming. It means having, valuing highly. He considered, right, God's promise. He considered the reproaches of Christ, the suffering he was going to go through. Greater riches than the what? Because he had respect unto the recompense. And y'all remember what recompense is. That God is going to make, God is going to make a return of an equivalent for anything given, done, or suffered. For services that you give to God, right? Now, if you do those things, if you do that, what if Moses was just doing that so, you know, all the Israelites would say, oh, you're such a holy man, Moses. He wanted to be seen of men. He would have no reward, right? When you choose these things, understand that you have to, with patience, wait for the Lord to return. When you stand before him, guess what? Then, and only then, will you receive the glory that is due to you. He says, knowing that he, which raised up the Lord Jesus, is going to do what? Raise up us what? He's going to raise us up also by Jesus. And you know what he's going to do? He shall present us with you. In other words, the Lord, when he raises you up and you've been faithful, you know what he's going to do before the Father? He said, Lord, look here. Look at Lewis. Look at Carlos. Look at Patricia and John and Love. Look at them. I'm presenting them to you. They were living sacrifices for you, Lord. They served you, believing that you were going to pay them back, not doing it so that they could have worldly profit and worldly gain. He says, for all things are for your sake, that the abundant grace might through the thanksgiving of many redound to the glory of God, for which cause we faint not. Don't quit running this race you're in. The longer the Lord lets you live, the more sacrifices you make, the more that you give to help people, guess what? He says, he that soweth sparingly shall reap sparingly, but he that soweth what? Bountiful shall reap bountiful. He says, but though our outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. Now look what he says, for our light affliction, the suffering that Moses went through after he left Egypt, do you think that it's going to be worth it to him one day?
Yes.
Do you think that the suffering that Noah probably received for building this big old boat, right? And and he was warning people, and Enoch, he was warning people, and all these things that they were suffering. Do you think that all the suffering that Israel's done, that they're not going to be paid back one day for all that? But God says something about it. He says it's a light affliction. And it, guess what? How long it lasts? Which is but for what?
A moment.
What's a moment? Your lifetime. What is your lifetime compared to eternity?
A moment.
Well, let me tell you, because I'm 62. Patricia, you're in your 70s. Carlos just turned 80. Your life is what? Nothing but a moment. And he's saying that light of affliction, that those sacrifices that you make for him, in service to him, worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of what? Glory. It's eternal. While we look not at the things which are seen. See, if all you are doing is looking at the nice houses and the nice cars and the big bank account and you just want to make your life comfortable, Moses could have chose that, couldn't he? He had it. But don't look on those things, because they're they don't last. He's telling you that this affliction you're going through that's only for a moment, a lifetime, has an exceeding and eternal weight of glory. But at the things which are not seen, for the things which are seen are what? Temporal. Look at that word temporal, right? Time. See, the things that we're going to receive one day are not for a certain amount of time. Time is opposed to what? Eternal. God doesn't live in time. He didn't. It wasn't a day he was born and a day he's going to die. He says eternal life, which was with the Father, right? And came down to us, right? He said temporal is pertaining to, guess what? This life or this world, measured or limited by time, having limited existence. The things that you can see with your eyes right now pass away. You can't keep that house. You can't keep that car. You can't keep that money. But you can use it to get you things which are what? Eternal. He goes on, he says, we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen. The things that are in heaven right now, you know what? They're eternal. They're not temporary. He says, and the devil, because the devil did this to the Lord, did he not? The devil taking him up into a high mountain showed him all the kingdoms of what? The world. Look, temporal, pertaining to this life or this what? World. They are what? Limited by time. So he's going to show him some things, the kingdoms of the world, which are limited by time. And he's going to show them to him in a what? Time. Moment of time, right? Remember what he said up here? That Moses chose to suffer the affliction with God and to enjoy the pleasures of sin for how long?
Season,
right? He said down here, our light affliction, which is but for what?
A moment.
And then when he gets down here, he says, he's going to show Christ all these temporal things of the world that were given to him, right?
Yes.
He's going to show all of them because for a moment in time. I can give you these. I'm the God of this world. And the devil said unto him, all this power will I give thee. And guess what? Lord, when men pat you on the back and tell you what a good person you are, God says, that is a dead work. You have your reward. When you stand before him and say, well, Lord, I did this and that. He said, I don't know you. You didn't do that for me. You did it for you. You did it because you wanted people to think that you are something. He says, for that is delivered to me and to whomsoever I will give it. So the devil's telling you, all you got to do, I'll give you all this temporal stuff. For a moment in time, if you'll just bow down and worship me, I'll give you the nice house. I'll give you the nice car. I'll give you the good job. Now there's a condition when your heart stops, your blood quits flowing through your veins, you don't have it anymore. All you got to do, if thou therefore will worship me, all shall be thine. And Jesus answered and said unto him, get thee behind me, Satan. It is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God. So what does it mean to worship him? When you worship him in the spirit and in truth, you know what it means? Look what it says here. He says, if you'll worship me, and the Lord says, no, you should worship the Lord. And him only shalt thou what? You know that when you serve the Lord, you are worshiping the Lord?
Yes.
And when you're serving the devil, guess what?
The devil.
You're giving him worship. If you bow down before him, you're doing what?
Worshiping.
That's all he wanted. That's all the devil wanted was him to do what? If thou therefore will what? Bow down and worship me. I'll give you all this stuff. All this temporal stuff, which is limited by time. It's not eternal. You cannot, he says, no man can serve. No man can worship. Right? Two masters. You can worship the God of this world or the God of all creation. One is going to reward you with temporal things for just a moment, and one is going to reward you with eternal things, right? Forever. Something that is not opposed to Arnold. He's going to give you eternal rewards and exceeding an eternal what? Weight of glory. But you have to choose. He says, you cannot serve. You can't, it's not possible to serve God and mammon. You can't serve God and the devil. You can't serve God and this world. You can't serve God and money. And since you can't serve, therefore, you know what I'm going to say to you? Don't take no thought for the life, because when you are taking thought for your life, guess what you're doing? You're serving mammon. Well, I need food. I got to work. Well, of course you do. But who are you serving? God, you don't think God knows that you have need of these things? Of course he does. Don't take no thought for your life, what you shall eat or what you should drink, nor yet for your body, what you shall put on. Is not the life, right, more than meat, and the body more than raiment? So, dead works are works that are not done in the faith that believes that God is a rewarder. Anything you do, right? Anything you do, if you don't believe that God's going to pay you back, the Bible says it is a dead work. And the only kind of works that give life to your faith is living works. He says, Jacob saw pottage. Esau came from the field and he was faint. And Esau said to Jacob, feed me, I pray thee, with that same red pottage, for I am faint. Therefore was his name called Edom. And Jacob said, sell me this day. I want to buy something from you, Esau. You got something that I don't have. I want to buy your birthright. You got the right to the inheritance. And Esau said, behold, I'm about to die. And what profit is this inheritance, this birthright going to do for me? Now, listen, if Esau, I could understand, because we're talking about a physical life and a physical worldly inheritance he would have got from his father, right? I can understand that if Esau was literally bleeding out, he was dying. He said, brother, if you'll save me, I'll give you my inheritance. I can understand that, right? But Esau wasn't going to die if he didn't get this meal.
Right.
Esau considered that meal, that worldly good, more important than what? His inheritance. And we live in a world where Christians do not think that their eternal inheritance, the kingdom, and all the glory and rewards that come with serving God are more important than serving the God of this world and having nice things and making their life easy. They would rather tear down their barn, build a bigger barn, and live in ease, rather than say, you know what? Man, that barn's full. What am I going to do with this? Oh, what shall I do? Well, why don't I just help some people? Give it away. We all make choices. And at the judgment seat, he's like, it's many are called, few are chosen. He said, most believers are like Esau. What profits my inheritance? I got to live in this world. I got to work. I got to have food. Don't take no thought for that. Thus, Esau despised his birthright. He despised his inheritance. You know how many believers despise their heavenly, eternal inheritance? We're not talking about eternal life here. We're talking about the reward of the inheritance. Look at that word despise, to disdain, to have the lowest opinion of, to deem worthless, to be unworthy of what? Notice, care, regard, or esteem. He did not care about it. His inheritance, because he didn't have it right then and there, that meal was more important to him. His inheritance was worth it. He did not esteem it important, which was the opposite up here of Moses, right? He esteemed the reproach of Christ greater riches. He valued it highly, whereas guess what? Esau deemed it worthless. See, people will, when I say people, I'm not, most people that are going to be listening to this are not unbelievers. We're talking to believers. We're talking to Christian children of God here. And you have to understand that this world's going to pass away, that your life is going to pass away, that God has an inheritance for you. But you know what most believers do? Well, I serve God. I do these works because I want to pay God back. That's a dead work. I do these works because I love God. Well, if you love him, keep his commandments. He says, he that cometh to me must believe that I'm a rewarder. If you are not seeking reward from God, you better ask yourself, what is your motive? Why are you doing it? Why was the Pharisees doing it? Why were they wearing long clothing?
To be seen
of men. Why were they making long prayers? To be seen of men. Why were they like disfiguring themselves when they were fasting? To be seen of men. God says, that's a dead work. You have your reward. He says, follow peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord, looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness springing up trouble you, and thereby many be defiled. Lest there be any fornicator or what it says, profane person, as Esau. Look profane. To violate anything sacred or treat it with irreverence or contempt. He considered his birthright, his inheritance, what? He had contempt again, irreverence. He didn't consider it. It was sacred. God considers the thing that he wants to give you as sacred and holy. He wants to give it to you, right? He says to pollute, to defile, to apply to, guess what kind of uses?
Temporal,
temporary. It's not temporary. God, this is an eternal inheritance, and you're going to be like Esau, a profane man who has contempt and irreverence for the thing he considers his inheritance and his birthright worthless. You know that how that afterward, look, like who for one, how much? One morsel of what? That's just one earthly good. So it doesn't matter whether it's one meal, a mansion. It doesn't matter whether it's like you're going to blackmail somebody or you're going to like be deceitful in business practices. It doesn't matter whether you want to just work overtime the rest of your life just so you can have stuff in this world. You're considering your inheritance just like Esau, as you're a profane person. You are profane. If that steps on my feet, that steps on anybody's feet, I don't care. It's what the scripture says. He says that, you know, that how afterward Esau, if he would have considered it important, then guess what he would have done? He would have inherited it, right? Right. But guess what? When he went before his father, he was what?
Rejected.
He was sorry. He was repentant. I'm sorry I did it, Lord. I'm sorry I did it, Father. I'm sorry. But though, guess what? His father, there was no place of repentance. Though he sought it carefully, with, he was crying to his father. There will be people, there will be believers, when they stand at the judgment seat to be judged based upon their works, whether good or bad, they're going to say, Lord, but I did this and I did that. We did many wonderful works, Lord. You know what the Lord's going to say to them? There's going to be weeping and gnashing of teeth. There's going to be tears. Because you consider this world and this life more important. You served the devil. You served the world. You served your lust instead of serving the living God, who rewards much, much greater. You got to choose. Do you want to suffer the affliction with the people of God? Or do you want to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season, a moment in time? Because it's temporal. He says, the Spirit itself bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. And if we're children, we're heirs. Carlos, Patricia, Lewis, Love, John, we are children. We have a right to the inheritance. We're joint heirs with Christ. Look at the word. Patricia, you're joint heir of Christ if so be that we what? Do you choose to suffer the affliction with God's people, or do you choose to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season or a moment in time? He says, you will be heir. You will be joint heir with Christ. You will get the kingdom. You'll get the rewards that come with it. If so be that we suffer with him, that we may all be also what? Glorified together. Do you want the glory that comes from men? Or do you want the glory that comes from this world? Remember, go back up here. I want you to see, remember what he offered Christ? He says, and the devil said unto him, all this power will I give thee, and what?
Glory.
But it's in this world, this temporal world, it is only for a moment in time. You can be glorified with Christ, an eternal, right? An exceeding and eternal glory. He says, I reckon that the sufferings of this present time, this moment in time, this season is not worthy to be compared with what? The glory which shall be revealed in you, Patricia, and you, Carlos, and you, Lewis, and you, John, and you, Love. It can't be compared because it's temporary. That's eternal. Not just during the kingdom, eternity. He says, if you then be risen with Christ, after everything we just learned, you know what you should do? Seek those things which are above. You can't see them, but God doesn't lie. Where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Don't just seek those things. Set your affection on what?
On things above.
Don't set your affection on the things of this world. Not on the things of what? The earth. Why? They're temporal. They don't last. You are dead and your life is hid with Christ. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then if you have set your affection, if you're seeking those things which are above, right? When he appears, then shall you also appear with him, how? In glory. It's conditional. You have to choose. No one's going to sit here. I can't force you to live righteous and holy. I can't force you to help people. I can't force you to do anything. God doesn't want to. He wants you to choose. He says, how can you believe? How can you have the faith that's required? Because you must believe that he's a rewarder, right? How can you believe which receive honor, what? One of another. If that's all you care about is people telling you how righteous and holy and what a good person you are, right? And you doing things so that you'll get worldly good from it. You're not going to believe this truth. How can you believe which receive honor one of another? And you're not seeking the honor that cometh from who? God only. He that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a what? Rewarder. That is, if you believe that, then you are seeking after the glory. That is the living works that give life to your faith. Abraham did it when he offered his son. Noah did it when he built the ark. You go through that chapter in Hebrews 11, and all of those men had something in common. They added living works to their faith. They weren't seeking glory from men, because most of them, what happened to most of them? Some were killed, some were stoned, cut asunder, right? Others were tortured, not accepting deliverance that what? They might attain unto a better resurrection. God is not, listen, be patient. He's not unrighteous to what? He sees in secret. You don't have to have people tell you to do this or do that. You're not serving the world. You're not serving them. He's not unrighteous to what? Forget your work and labor of love, which you have showed toward his name, because you're serving him. You can't serve the world and him. He won't forget it, in that you have ministered to the saints and do minister. And we desire that every one of you, I desire that all of you do show the same diligence to the full assurance of hope to the end of your life, which is but a moment, right? Because it's not, you can't compare the suffering you're going through to the glory that you're going to get one day, to the inheritance you're going to get. Don't be slothful, but followers of them, follow, listen, I'll be an example. Follow those people, those believers, who through faith and patience, guess what they get to do one day? That same inheritance that was promised to Abraham, right? One day you're going to get to sit down with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, right? And in the kingdom. But then there are going to be those believers, right? That are going to be cast out. You know why they were cast out? Because they considered this present world more valuable. They were profane like Esau. They thought, wow, I got to have food. I got, what good is that inheritance going to do me now? I'm at the point of dying. All right. That's all I got, guys. So